This video will explain how to estimate changes in the stresses under different loads, and we're going to look at this practical example when we have soil conditions, sand and clay, and then we're going to apply some load which is equal to Q. And let's look at the sand first. We know that sand is about 3 meters thick. There is groundwater level which is 1.5 meters below the ground surface. We also know that the unit weight of sand above the groundwater level is 18 kilonewtons per cubic meters, and below the groundwater level is going to be 21 kilonewtons per cubic meters. We also know that the clay has the unit weight of 20 kilonewtons per cubic meters, and at this point B it's 3 meters in the clay. So when we apply this load, which is Q and equal 150 kilonewton per square meters, we know that there will be change in the vertical stress at point B, which is equal 0.8 times Q. And there is also going to be a change in the horizontal stress, which is equal to 0.23 times Q. So once we need to find the changes in the stresses, and the soil is saturated because we see that groundwater level is above the clay layer, there will be also changes in the pore water pressure. And to find the changes in the pore water pressure, we're going to use this formula. I think there's only one formula that will tell us how pore water pressure changes with changes in the stresses. So you will see we would need to know changes in the vertical stress, changes in the horizontal stress, and we need to know these two parameters, A and B. So A is given here in the text of the problem. It says the Kepler's A parameter is 0.4. There is no information about B, but you need to remember that for soil that is saturated, B is equal to 1. And what we need to do, in addition to calculate the total and effective stresses, vertical stresses and horizontal stresses at point B immediately after load, we also need to calculate stresses in the changes in the vertical strain at point B, also immediately under the load is applied. So the difference between immediate application and, let's say, long-term application, maybe 5 or 6 years, is that when we apply the load immediately, there is going to be a generation of pore water pressure. And most likely we're going to have undrained conditions. So in a short term, we have undrained conditions, but let's say over a long period of time, for example, 5 or 6 years, when excess pore water pressure dissipates, then we will change to drain conditions. But in this case, most likely we will deal with undrained conditions. And the thing that we also need to know is youngest modulus for undrained conditions. You see, you are given youngest modulus for drain and undrained conditions, but for this particular purpose, for this particular exercise, we're going to use only this value, which is undrained conditions. So now let's start working out this problem, and we will start with the calculation of stresses before the application of the load. So I hope you already know how to do that. We're going to first start with the vertical stress. Vertical stress, it will be equal 1.5 meters of sand times the unit weight of first layer of sand, which is 18, plus 1.5 meters of sand under the groundwater level. The unit weight is 21. And we have also 3 meters to point B in the clay, which has 20 kilonewtons per square meters unit weight. So it will give us approximately 118.5 kilonewtons per square meters. So next step is to estimate the pore water pressure. And to estimate pore water pressure, we need to find the pressure head. We're going to look at point B, and the distance of point B to the groundwater level, you see, is going to be 4.5 meters. So what we're going to write is 4.5 meters times the unit weight of water will give us approximately 44 and 15 kilonewtons per square meters. So next step is the effective stress, which is the difference between total stress and pore pressure. So in this case, we're going to get effective stress of approximately 7435 kilonewton per square meters. So now we can find the horizontal effective stress. If we know the coefficient of earth pressure at rest, let's assume that K0 is 0.9. So in this case, the effective horizontal stress would be effective vertical stress times K0. And that will give us 74.35 times 0.9, approximately 66.92 kilonewton per square meters. And then the total horizontal stress will be equal to effective stress plus pore pressure. And then will approximately give us 111.1 kilonewton per square meters. Okay, so this is the stress conditions before we apply any load. So now let's see what is going to be changed in the vertical and horizontal stresses after we apply the load. And we're going to use this theory of elasticity, which is given to us the numbers. So vertical stress will increase by 0.8 times Q, which is 0.8, and Q is 150. It was already given to us. So it will give us 120 kilonewtons per square meters. The increase in horizontal stress will be 0.23 times Q, which approximately 34.5 kilonewtons per square meters. So this means that when we apply this load, there will be increase at point B. So the vertical stress will increase by this much, while the horizontal stress will increase by this value. So now let's find what is going to be changed in the pore pressure. And to find the change in pore pressure, we're going to use this formula. So as we already discussed, the B parameter is equal to 1 because the solus is saturated, and parameter A is given to us, it's 0.4. Parameter A typically depends on the type of soil. So if we put the numbers in the formula, we will find that delta U is equal to 1. Then we have a change in sigma 3. Sigma 3 we typically assume it's a horizontal stress. And sigma 1 is a vertical stress. So we have 34.5 plus 0.4 times 120 minus 34.5 will give us approximately 68.7 kilonewton per square meters. So this will be the change in the pore pressure immediately after we applied load. Of course, there is no dissipation of pore pressure because there is not enough time and the clay is saturated. As you know, that water flows very slowly in the clay. So now we will see that the new vertical stress will be equal to the initial stress 118.5. times this additional vertical stress will give us approximately 238.5 kilonewton per square meters. New horizontal stress will be 111.07, which was the initial value, plus 34.5, which is an increase in the horizontal stress due to the load. That will give us 145.57 kilonewtons per square meters. And change in the pore pressure will be the initial pore pressure, which is 44 and 15, plus the pore pressure increment, which is 68.7, will give us approximately 112.85 kilonewton per square meters. So, and finally, we're going to have new effective stresses. So new effective vertical stress will be the total stress, which is 238.5 minus new pore pressure, which is 112.85, and that will give us approximately 125.66 kilonewton per square meters. And the new effective horizontal stress will be equal to 145.57 minus pore to pressure 85, will give us approximately 32.72 kilonewton per square meters. So now let's also find the changes in the axial strain at point B. So in this case, we know that it's immediate after apply load, which means that under end conditions. And for the under end conditions, you need to remember that Poisson's ratio is equal to 0.5. So what we're going to do is we're going to put all the numbers that we have found so far to estimate changes in the strain conditions. So Andrian youngest modulus was 2000 kilonewton per square meters, which was already given to us. Then we're going to change in the vertical stress, which is 120. So this is 120 that we use. Now we have minus the Andrian Poisson's ratio is 0.5 times 2, and time change in the horizontal stress, which is 34.5. I'm going to write it here, 34.5. And that will give us the axial strain of 0.043 for the point B.